To start out the video, let us go over just the basic practices, practices that anybody can use, no matter what your background is, religious, spiritual, belief system, background. All right. The first step in right spiritual practice is mood of repentance. Mood of repentance. That you're calm, you're sober, you're serious, you're not all hyped up, you're not all amped up, you're sort of in a neutral state, you're non-reactive, non-emotive, you're not argumentative, right? You're very collected and serious and focused. And the most important aspect, once we get that the basics there and we're feeling that we're not in a rush to get anywhere, also, the mood of repentance starts the process of spiritual practice by confessing. The confession, first confession is, I have a continuity problem. I have a severe continuity problem. That sets the tone. Now, anybody from any walk of life, any age, any religious, spiritual background or non-background, no matter what, can say, you know, I have a severe continuity problem. The continuity problem means we have a dread of an abrupt shift of experiencing into experiencing that we're totally unfamiliar with. Even more dreadful is the notion of an abrupt shift into experiencing we're totally unfamiliar with, and that be permanent for us. So we defend against that. We will hold on to what is familiar to us, no matter how terrible it is. We will cling to it out of fear of the continuity problem. So, why are we doing right spiritual practice? Because we are clinging to what is terrible for us. We're clinging to this hideous nightmare, actually. But we won't set it down because of the continuity problem. We will not set it down. There's a saying, be it ever so humble, there's no place like home. So familiarity wins out every time. So what is right spiritual practice? Right spiritual practice is to turn our attention to practicing a new familiarity, a familiarity that enables us to exchange this hideous nightmare we have for this wonderful, smoothed out experiencing of what's called the vision of oneness, the goal of all spiritual, right spiritual practice. No matter what the terminology is used, no matter what the religion or non-religion or whatever, it's the vision of oneness is the goal. Now, Judeo-Christians can call it the vision of Christ. Others, Hindus might call it the vision of Krishna or Krishna consciousness. Others may call it, you know, different terminologies. But here, to try to be truly ecumenical, which I tend to be that way, to be all-inclusive, vision of oneness. What does that mean? One identity. There's only one identity, actually. We don't see that right now. We think that everything has a different identity because of perception deludes us into this misperception. Jesus once said in A Course in Miracles, perception is misperception. Something like that. So right spiritual practice aims at getting us into a comfort zone with the vision of oneness. A soft landing helps us make a soft landing. The vision of oneness itself is a very soft landing back to reality. Very soft landing. It reminds us of reality to an extraordinary extent, even though we're still in the field of perception. Okay, there's one final step even beyond the vision of oneness, but that doesn't concern us here in the slightest bit. And that is simply just direct, total knowing. And that's beyond the scope of what practice can bring anybody to. We are practicing a soft landing into the vision of oneness. All right spiritual practice is aimed towards that. And there are lots of different nomenclatures are used, etc. And people succeed. Eventually, people succeed. Now, generally speaking, in the past, people have had glimpses of the vision of oneness, and it tends to come and go. What we're aiming for is stable, okay? Stable vision of oneness, equal vision, Christ, vision of Christ, etc., etc. Is we want to abide in it. We want to abide in this. Ramana Maharshi called this one identity the self. He said, abide as the self, in the self. Abide as that. Abide as that one identity, that vision, that awareness. There's only one all-pervasive, immaculately pure identity, consciousness, awareness, being, God. You see, just one. Not many, just one. So we think, oh, that's such a high goal. Maybe one day I can catch a glimpse of it. No. We can abide as that. No question. No question about it. It's simply, we have to value that. It's the valuing of that that's all important, because we will not attempt what we see has no value or little value. We say, why should I put a lot of effort into something that doesn't have much value for me? So here in comes the theme of these times in this video, at least to start out with, is the valuing problem. And right spiritual practice places the value of the vision of oneness front and center as the only value there is, because only that solves our continuity problem, our dread of letting go of this ghastly nightmare, really, that we have, this nightmare of impermanence and death and vulnerability and confusion and mental anguish and fear and isolation and anxiety, depression, attack, hatreds, you know, just everything, and on and on and on and on and on. This is a nightmare, actually. This is a nightmare of feeling that we have some different identity other than the one, that there's some separate other identity, fragmented, separated will, all this stuff. It's a dream. It's a nightmare, though. So we're making a soft landing, a soft awakening, like waking out of a coma, really smoothly and easily. We can do the exercises. We can do it. The glimpses that I have had came directly from these exercises. And I said, hey, that's wonderful. That's not that bad. It's really wonderful, for sure. It's the best news you could ever possibly imagine. It's good news beyond all imagination to see that there's only this one identity, without a second, without another. So placing, without seeing that, we will cling to this nightmare. So really, the vision of oneness is the only value there really is. Because clinging to a nightmare that is totally unnecessary has no real value at all. Unless it's to protect from the continuity problem, right? But right spiritual exercises enable this continuity problem to easily and softly resolve into the vision of oneness. So that's the only real value there is. Right spiritual exercises that lead to the vision of oneness, that complex of right spiritual exercises, vision of oneness. That's really the only value there is. There is no other value at all. So that's why we say you have to put it front and center, or else you're going to continue to double down on dreaming. Go deeper into a coma. Because you'll feel, I'm starting to wake. Oh my gosh, this is too frightening. I got to go back deep, even deeper into sleep, so I won't have this terrible sphere again. You know, the problem is this coma we're in, a forgetfulness of reality, the one identity, is we tend to go deeper into it, because as we start to naturally awaken from it, because we're attracted to truth, being that we are truth, created as truth, it scares us so badly that we tend to then try and go even deeper into a coma. And it's a really very, very vulnerable to ideology which persuades us to go even deeper into a coma. Very, very vulnerable to that. Because a lack of teaching, a lack of teachers, a lack of focus, a lack of valuing on working right spiritual exercises that work on the continuity problem, providing a soft landing into the ultimate soft landing which is the vision of oneness, which is a soft landing actually back into reality. So you might say there's a couple steps, a soft landing into the vision of oneness, and the vision of oneness is the soft landing back into full awareness of reality, full knowing of reality as it is. So what we're going to do is we're going to zoom in onto this planet here. We're on this, we find ourselves, at least we think we find ourselves here on this planet, and with this nightmare, really, of what we call existence life. It's really a deep, deep coma of all these complexes and concerns and everything. And we're trying to have a soft awakening from that coma into the vision of oneness, okay? In order to do that, we have to value right spiritual practice. Have to value it above anything else, way above anything else. It's kind of like breathing. I mean, if you can't breathe, don't you value breathing more than anything at that moment? Absolutely. Well, right spiritual practice, it has even higher value than breathing, so to speak. Of course, we need to be breathing to do it, but it's like even more essential. Even more essential than breathing, actually. So we need to value it in that way, that it's the highest value, the most central value to everyone's lives. The most central. Everything else is a very, 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 very distant second. Very distant. This is the attitude that everyone must have to awaken from this coma. Otherwise, they're going to try and cling ever more tightly to this coma. So, being aware of this situation, one can look at the world and make assessments, make very clear assessments of the dynamics of the world. Is everybody making this right spiritual practice the most central value of their life by far and away, and are doing it every day as if their, you know, their sanity depended upon it? That's the question, right? So, In being aware of this and evaluating it, what I found is I've taken the sort of a temperature of the world of right spiritual practice. How much is, you know, how much intensity, how much is that valued as a personal, neighborhood, community, town, city, county, state, country, hemisphere, world, right? How much is it valued? How much is it valued in all walks of life? Social discourse. How welcome is that? You know, when you go someplace, do you feel that everyone around you is supporting putting right spiritual practice as the central issue of their interactions, of the life of the day, the life of the year, the purpose of life? You know, how prevalent is that? Well, to be realistic, I would say it's not very prevalent. It's super rare, actually, in the world. But the bigger issue is people tend to be ambivalent about it. There's a ambivalence that happens. So you go through times when you feel like, yeah, let me go in that direction. And then you go through other times, you say, I'm not sure, I'm a little bit worried. Because the continuity issue seems to be this terrible monster that frightens you so bad. And it's not really explained properly in this world, that what we really suffer from is this continuity problem. So there are ups and downs in this right spiritual practice aspiration, actually, you know, being supportive of this. We're in a severe down phase, have been for quite some time, but there's other issues, actually. There's also times when there's a great concerted effort to deepen the coma and to devalue right spiritual practice. And this is what I have to talk about here, I have talked about extensively in other videos, is what I have seen and what others have seen, and this information has been shared among various people with awareness of the situation, is there is a very vast and intense concerted effort to devalue right spiritual practice on this planet. And this has been sort of a long-term aim from those who believe that going deeper into the coma is the answer. Okay, deeper into a coma of forgetfulness. They believe that if everybody just continues to go deeper and deeper and deeper into the coma, at some point they'll reach some magical revelation from that, and they will be live happily ever after. There is that ideology, not only on this planet, but throughout the entire universe, actually. And not only in the grosser realms, but the subtler realms, too. This is an extremely misguided ideology, actually. We call it the egoic plan of salvation. And when this egoic plan of salvation focuses on our world, as it were, makes a concerted effort to convert the world to its plan, then you have a real problem on the planet. It's a crisis, actually. So what I'm looking at, what I see in this world, is that we are in this crisis. Now, people talk about World War III. Will World War III happen? Well, keep in mind that at this time in the world, warfare is ideological. It's ideological. Okay. The warfare that's taking place in this world is a battle for your mind. Okay, it's a battle for your mind. Because once the mind is captured, the body follows, right? Your actions follow. And we have at this time unprecedented techniques and tools on this planet now to capture the mind, so to speak, the ideology of the mind, to brainwash people, to indoctrinate the mind to an extraordinary extent. And this is what I see has been taking place and is taking place now on an unprecedented level, crisis level that deserves being called World War III, actually. And the way I look at it, I actually, from what I, my temperature taking of this overall situation in the world, noticing, I would say World War III started today, on Monday, March 10th, 2014, really. A blitzkrieg, really a very, very strong blitzkrieg, a big push to push this ideology of devaluing right spiritual practice and an attempt to drive the world away from right spiritual practice through very strong ideological pressure. Okay, very nasty stuff, actually. It's really, I feel like the missiles were launched today. This ideological push reached a new level of intensity that it's worth referring to it as World War III has just broken out today. That is how I actually view it. Ideological, right? So no missiles have been launched physically, but ideological intensity has been ramped up to a point. It's kind of like crossing a border. It's like crossing a border and subjugating the citizens of a certain country. Once you cross that border, you have to say that your intentions are not welcome at that point, right? I mean, you can be massing on a border, but people say, well, we don't know what they're going to do. Once you cross a certain line, an ideological line, with enough intensity, then you have basically declared war on that country that you're crossing the border. Same with ideological warfare. And I believe that lines have been crossed, very significant lines have been crossed that represent, no doubt about it, a huge push. I've been warned about this. I've seen it coming. I said it would happen from the period after President's Day, from March 17th, from February 17th to March 17th, that 1 month period. I said, this is what's going to happen. This is the push, the blitzkrieg, the push is going to happen, and it is happening, just like clockwork. Just a massive storm of ideological, intense ideological indoctrination and intimidation has taken place. Basically, putting enormous pressure on people to toe the line and devalue right spiritual practice, okay? And to actually go deeper in the coma and to accept leadership from those who devalue right spiritual practice. See, this is the key in ideological warfare, is you accept orders and advice, and actually value is called the cult of personality. This world, it has been pressured and driven into what I call cult of personality. And this is the devaluing of right spiritual progress. This is how we do it. We focus on the personality and all of the attributes of a personality, with all the judgments that inherently rise from sensory perception, actually. Sensory perception inherently generates this non-stop judgment of false identity. And this judgment of false identity we call the personality. And at that level of misperception, false judgment of identity, at that level of all of this stuff, there isn't any way to sort it out and to figure out what's going on and to cure it and to provide a soft landing into the vision of oneness. There isn't any way at that level. You only get into conflicts and control trips and all this stuff. It's been taking place for time immemorial. You can't solve a problem of causation at the level of effects directly. You have to turn it around towards causation, real causation. And when we're stuck at the level of personality, we're not dealing with anything. We're essentially getting nowhere, but actually we're deepening our coma. We're deepening it. And this is something that people don't understand very well here, but I sure do. And there are some that really do understand this very, very clearly. So this cult of personality takes its tips, its cues, its verbiage, its reactions. It's an actual cult. This whole planet has been turned into a cult of personality. This is a cult. It's a dangerous, dangerous cult. Okay? Very dangerous cult. And that the idea of right spiritual practice is ridiculed. It is suppressed. It is repressed. It is not welcome in the slightest bit. And it simply doesn't arise in the cult of personality. The personality wants to make itself God. You know, this is it. The personality is it. This is the goal. That's actually deepening the coma. This is the ego's plan of salvation, is to worship, idolize the personality, and to take your leadership cues from personalities, those who are focused at the level of personality instead of the level of right spiritual practice or the level of spirit, vision of the one identity, vision of oneness. Okay. In the past, we have had periods where people tried to take their leadership cues from the vision, those who have the vision of oneness, who are establishing the vision, which the great saints, the great sages, the great avatars, the great gurus, the great rabbis, in every tradition, there are those who are establishing the vision of oneness, and they write a prescription for society, saying, look, we need to arrange society in this particular way, de-emphasize the personality. Okay, it's very important. De-emphasize the opinions of sensory perception. The personality is just the judgment and opinions of sensory perception, which is totally delusional. Totally delusional. It actually sees all sorts of gradations and levels and differentiations of identity, which is totally delusional. So de-emphasize the personality, de-emphasize the cult of the personality, which involves worshiping the body, which is sensory perception, actually. You know, really worshiping sensory perception and its judgments and opinions, etc. De-emphasize all that. Emphasize right spiritual practice. Many civilizations and societies have had that, an element of that, or sometimes a strong element of that throughout history. This time right now is actually unprecedented on this planet. It's actually an unprecedented, terrible time on this planet. An unprecedented crisis. This is the crisis that has been foretold in various traditions. For instance, the Judeo-Christian tradition talks about the end of this age, where people will fall away from right spiritual practice to such an extreme extent. They will become so idolatrous of personalities. This personality cult will grow so extreme that even those who are most serious about right spiritual practice may give it up. Okay, they may give it up. That is the prophecy that is actually contained in the Judeo-Christian tradition in the Bible. Is we are told that we will reach this time and be warned about it. And we say we need to really, really amp up our efforts. Well, guess what? We are in those times. We are in those times right now, officially, and the intensity of it warrants saying that it's World War III. This is the crisis. It's called different things, the tribulation, the end times, all this stuff, these terminologies. We are in it. We are in it. It is happening. And it is true that even those most dedicated to right spiritual practice are falling away from it. I find that this is true. I find that many wonderful people have fallen away, and they find it too difficult to get the will to do it because their will has been targeted. Their will has been targeted. That's the target, is the will to do it, saying that, oh, you're somehow wrong or guilty or have a deficient will if you use your will this way, that we're supposed to use our will to idolize the personality, okay, and worship, bow down to those who have these all-confident personalities, you know. Now, a confident, arrogant, narcissistic personality is a far cry from someone in the vision of oneness, okay? Far cry. And I have seen both, and I've been able to compare the two. Night and day. Night and day. Okay? So, we don't have any trouble discerning the difference between the two. Nobody does at all. It's the fact is, the continuity problem makes us play dumb, okay? This is our problem. The only problem we have is the continuity problem. It makes us play dumb, it seems to paralyze our will, and it makes us vulnerable to those who are trying to deepen our coma, who are following the ego's plan of salvation, thinking that they've been promised a choice role in it, like they're going to be a super personality ruling over other personalities. So they're eager to advance this agenda, thinking it's their salvation. So we are in the time when even those who are most dedicated and disciplined tend to lose their focus on right spiritual practice, and it erodes and it crumbles, and they find themselves unable to do it. And that's what I'm seeing. It's a surprise on the internet that I've not been able to reach more people to encourage them to focus in on this. And some have commented on that. Say, it's amazing. How come there are not more watching? It's because of this. It's because people's will, the continuity problem, causes such a dread fear, and couple that with the ego's plan being presented in this world to such a glamorous extent. It's been glamorized, made to seem super sexy. The ego's plan of salvation, which is to deepen your coma, okay? That people have just like, they just can't seem to focus. And I can tell you that I have literally spent my entire life working as hard as I possibly can just to retain this focus and will that I have. It's been a non-stop battle, so I can only imagine what it's like for those who had a lot of other things that they were focusing on. Yeah, you get steamrolled. However, there seem to be some of those who seem to have a lot of good resistance to this the ego's plan, and that they're able to focus to some extent. So we certainly are working as much as possible to continue this outreach to those. Not sure how it'll go. And not sure exactly what this response is. I say World War III has broken out today. And I'm calling it. And so I'm responding to the situation as if we are in now a declaration of war on this planet. A war against right spiritual practice and those who want to orient in that direction. And an attempt to establish the ego's plan of salvation as the only option there is on this planet. That is what is taking place. And this is a way, way more severe thing than actual physical warfare, physical combat. Way more severe, because it can drag everybody down into like a black hole, really. It's like, it's really an attempt to drag us all down into this black hole. And when you get to the bottom of that black hole, as I have, and so I know what I'm talking about here, you don't find yourself some super personality. You find yourself in total mental chaos, is what you find. So the ego's plan of salvation is a total dud from the very beginning. 100% failure. It will never work for anybody. And yet you have this entire planet going pell-mell into this black hole. It results in severe depression, severe anxiety, and really off the charts. I mean, total mental chaos is beyond even depression. You would welcome depression after that, I guarantee you. What the ego's plan of salvation really aims for is to destroy us entirely, annihilate us entirely. It's really after its safety. The quote-unquote ego safety. Our defenses are pretending that they're an identity, and they feel the only way that they can gain a stable identity is to annihilate the maker of all this, you know, which is us. So really, the projections of spirit tried to project a new, different identity, and this so-called different identity, separate from the one identity, feels insecure. And it believes that the way to cure this insecurity is to get rid of its maker, which is us. So it really, ego really is trying to find a way to totally annihilate us. And the most it can do is bring us total mental chaos. But the mind is still there. The awareness is still immaculate. It's just that we're experiencing total chaos, which is, it's a non-starter. And we say, that's not at all what I want to experience. And we reject it. So, the ego cannot destroy us, but it can push us down deeper and deeper, deeper, deeper into this black hole, where we go more and more and more into the state of mental chaos, where we end up in extremely fascistic types of control cultures, and it's just a bleak, bleak, bleak dystopian situation when we go with the cult of personality. And the cult of personality, again, is dominating this planet to such an alarming extent that it is a total crisis. You just ask yourself, how many have the will to be able to speak clearly on this, all right, without panic, without fear, without compromise, you know, and you can tell that they are continuing their right spiritual practice going on. So, not so many really on this planet, right? And they seem to be disappearing more and more all the time. And there's reasons for that. They're being pressured. They're being pressured into ending their efforts, into compromise efforts that don't work, into tricky egoic practices that actually cause them to begin to sink down deeper into a coma. All right, so. It's a time when we will see what kind of remedies there are for the situation now. I'm absolutely expectant of some sort of boost at this time. Now that this, in my opinion, you know, when war is declared, when a country like blitzkriegs into another country and we realize, hey, this is active aggression. When the acts of ideological aggression cross a line, and this is really war, you know, ideological warfare, then people decide what side to align upon. Just like World War II, you had the Allies and the Axis, okay? Different countries aligned with different sides. So you have alignments taking place and deciding what side am I on this? Am I on the side of the ego's plan of salvation to deepen the coma? To the ultimate extent, which is actually to try and annihilate ourselves, or am I with what we call, you know, God's plan of salvation, the Holy Spirit's plan of salvation, really what I call it, the vision of oneness, okay? We can use whatever terms, but I want to be all-inclusive to everybody here. And, you know, people who do right spiritual practice are not offended by different terminologies because they know the goal is this vision of oneness, this one identity, this wonderfully forgiving vision where it just everything is totally forgiven. You know, you completely transcend the level of perception and personality, and you're viewing things, and you're just very loving, very peaceful, very calm, very blissful, and everybody knows that there is that goal, and it doesn't matter what kind of name or label you put on it. The ego tries to get people to fight among one another, like, you know, sectarian squabbles in religions and stuff. The ego is the one that's fostering that. Okay, the ego tries to exploit ambivalence and cause all sorts of wars and conflicts and sectarian battles, etc., like that, to try and throw a wrench into the whole thing. So what we do here is we are very ecumenical, very universal in our approach, and at the same time very practical. I understand perfectly well that we live in a society that has these various traditions, and the Judeo-Christian tradition is a very long-standing, very well-known tradition. And so sometimes I use terminology from that. Sometimes I use terminology that you might say comes from the Buddhist tradition, and sometimes from the Hindu tradition, etc. And I'm not making any attempt to exclude any tradition. I'm just sort of going with what I am familiar with, and I know a lot of the listeners are familiar with. But anybody from any background and tradition can easily get the gist of what's being said. We have a continuity problem, okay? It's totally pragmatic, our problem. It's totally, we're afraid of waking up from this coma of forgetfulness because we've forgotten reality entirely. We've forgotten it entirely. We just don't know what it's like at all. And how will we function? What do you mean non-localized identity? What do you mean, you know, what are you talking about? No inside, no outside. Scared. So, the ego exploits this continuity problem from those who don't realize they're suffering from it. The way to turn this around is the first step in your spiritual practice, besides a basic mood of repentance. The mood of repentance includes the confession that I have a severe continuity problem. I have a severe continuity problem. Once you own that problem, the ego cannot exploit it the way it has been. It cannot bring about as much sectarian violence and anger and hostility, etc., etc., because you realize I have a severe continuity problem. Everybody has a severe continuity problem, and that's the only problem we really have. Everybody's the same. We have a continuity problem. That is not a sectarian, it is not something that you say, well, only Buddhists have a continuity problem, or only Buddhists don't, or whatever, only Christians. No, we all have the exact same basic continuity problem, everybody. So this is really a universal declaration. It's a declaration that can play anywhere. I have a severe continuity problem. It's like, let's say, on a real hot summer day, people are up in the mountains, and there's this river flowing down, and there's this big pool in the river up in the mountains, and it's water from the snow, and it's like icy cold, and you get all these people, and they're hot and sweating from hiking, and everybody's looking at that cool water, and they're all thinking the same thing. I'd like to jump in that. I'd really like to jump in there, but I think it's too cold. I'm nervous as heck because I think it's too cold. That's example, like for instance, an example of a continuity problem, right? Everybody's thinking the same thing. You can have people of all ages, dispositions, beliefs, backgrounds, whatever. They're sitting there by that river and they're thinking, boy, I don't know if I want to do that. The shock of jumping in that icy cold water, it's going to really just shock my system, you know? So maybe we get down the river and we kind of dip our toes in, you know? Everybody's thinking the same thing. It's exactly the same way in this coma of forgetfulness that we are in. Everybody is thinking the same thing. I just need to awaken slowly from this. I can't just leap into, you know, instant awakening. And no. We all have the same fear, actually. Everybody has the same fear. This is what I'm trying to convey. Because this knocks the ego out. This absolutely turns the tables on the ego. It loses its leverage over us when we confess that we have a severe continuity problem. Now, in the Judeo-Christian tradition, this is actually was part of the tradition and still is. For instance, in Catholic Mass, at the beginning, you make your confession of repentance. Of these start out there, but the focus is not as clear and as tight as it's supposed to be. It's not as good as it should be. Okay, because it's saying that we've sinned in our thought, in our deed. We've sinned against God in our thought, in our deed, in all this, these actions. That's personality level. Okay, that won't cut it. That won't cut it. That's saying I'm a sinner at the level of the personality. No, the confession is to say I, spirit, have a continuity problem with remembering reality. We're saying, God, I know I am spirit and not a body or not a personality, but I'm clinging to the body-personality complex because I can't remember what reality's like, because I tried to uncreate reality. I tried to uncreate creation. And in doing so, I got myself tied up in so many knots and which way, you know, I don't know which way's up or down or anything. I'm so confused. It's a spiritual declaration of a confession. So not a personality confession. So the form of confession is correctly placed at the beginning of a spirit mass, for instance, in the Catholic Church. But the clarity of the declaration has been lost. It's not there anymore. If it ever was, I assume that the purpose was at some point much more clear. But no, it's a spiritual confession. It's saying, God, I have forgotten reality. I'm spirit. I know that your kingdom is my one and only home, but I'm clinging to this delusionary home, this imaginary home that I think, you know, I know it's not real, I know it's imaginary, but I can't let it go because I'd forgotten reality and I'm too afraid to jump in. And the whole purpose of spiritual effort is based on this confession of continuity problem, because God meets us there. That is where we meet God. It's God's remedy. And God says, I know you have this continuity problem. There's no question about it. This is the only problem you have. So let's work on this problem. And I have given you the grace to work on this problem. Grace will meet you. Grace will come rushing to meet you when you confess that you have this problem. And when that grace then comes to reach you, how's it, in what form does it come? In the form of right spiritual practice. That is grace. Right spiritual practice is the grace of God. And people are looking for it everywhere else. The great, great Hindu avatar, Sri Sri Anandamayi Maha, said exactly this, that right spiritual practice, the motivation, the will, and the practice, all of that complex, that is the grace of God. That is it. And everybody is looking for grace somewhere else. But if you are able to do right spiritual practice, that is the action of God's grace in you. No question about it. No question about it. So it's all about right spiritual practice. If you're not doing it, it means you need more grace in your life, which means you need to start out with a confession. God, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a clue what reality is like, and I'm too afraid to wake up real quickly, so I need a soft landing into the vision of oneness. Very simple stuff here. We're not talking rocket science really at all. And it's not like we haven't been taught this before, it hasn't been clarified. It's simply that there's been this massive effort to turn us away from right spiritual effort, based on the severe delusions of those who have taken the egoic path, thinking that their salvation comes from controlling everybody else and bullying everybody else and putting them on a guilt trip and making them bow to them and worship them as idols. And believing that this planet is a perfect place to instill this idolatry, actually, like the cult of the personality. We've lost our bearings a little bit. So what I'm doing here is I'm saying, look, we need to regain our bearings. You start out with your overall focus, serious, sober, calm, non-reactive, not thinking you gotta react to anything, go anywhere, do anything. Non-emotive, you're not trying to express strong emotions. non-argumentative, you know, you let all that go and you're just here in a humble, humble, humble way to start out with a confession. You're here to confess that you have a severe problem and you're here to work on that problem. That is what right spiritual practice, that is what going to church or the temple or the ashram, wherever you go, the mosque, wherever you go, the meditation hall, you name it. That is what it's all about, is saying coming there to say, you know what, I have this incredibly severe problem. It's the most important problem there is. It's really the only problem I really have, and I'm here to work on it and really make a lot of progress on this. That's it. That's what it is. And the ego is rabidly against that. And it is distorting at a fanatical pace. Only an absolute fanatic could distort the way the ego is going about distorting everything, twisting and distorting. You might say the ego is just this insane, iconoclastic maniac at loose in the world, a Frankenstein monster that is trying to confuse everybody and turn them away from that. And one of the ways it does is watering down the whole experience of working on this, watering it down until people are just kind of just sitting there saying, why? I don't know why I'm here. It's just habit. You go to church. I go to Catholic Mass. I'm not a Catholic, but I've been going to Catholic Mass for years and years. Every week. Don't miss a week. And so I've seen the entire liturgical calendar. I've seen everything that goes on. Very, very well acquainted with it. And I'm telling you, the people there are just like, it's habit. They go there. The fire has gone out. The fire has gone out. They nod, okay, and say, okay, this is my duty. I'm supposed to do this. But, you know, the fire has really gone out in spite of the peppy songs and all this kind of stuff. It's just not happening. It's been watered down. And people's will has been so deflated. Because you can go to a place of worship and just be present there bodily, but your mind, the will is not there. I can tell the will is not there. It's so tepid. People are, their will is like crushed, you know, just crushed. And they're hoping, well, you know, maybe magically I'll be saved. Even though my will is not with it, you know, and I just can't, no, but maybe there's some magic way that if I just show up here, I'll be saved. Doesn't work that way. You have to engage in right spiritual practice to make a soft landing in the vision of oneness. If you don't reach and abide in the vision of oneness, you're not saved. You are not saved unless you abide in the vision of oneness. There is no way around it. There is no way around it. I don't care what anybody else has to say on this. This is a fact. And of course, it's hard to get people to go to church if you tell the truth to them. They'll say, I don't have the will to do that. I guess I better just quit. So right now, church is places of worship around the world. Whatever name you refer to places of worship are caught in this very severe ambivalent problem, is they don't want to lose their membership. Okay. Because they think, oh my God, that'd be really terrible. So, but they can't really give the right focus of will, because people don't have the will anymore. They've been so undermined and termited by the egoic plan of salvation on this planet, called the personality. They don't have the will anymore. So these places of worship are saying, wow, what do we do? You know, let's keep them coming somehow. You know, let's entice them here with good food, nice songs, and you know, peppy whatever talk is, But what happens is nothing's happening there. Nothing's happening. They don't want to lose their whole congregation. But if insisted on right spiritual practice, really insisted on getting effectiveness, nobody would show up. Nobody would show up. That's how bad it is. So you have this incredible tepidness in the world right now, which the ego loves. The ego loves tepidness. The ego loves for you to make it seem like you are doing the right thing, even though you're failing completely. Because then you don't say, hey, wait a minute, this isn't working. You think, no, I'm going to a place of worship regularly. But the will isn't there, so nothing's happening. But you think, oh yeah, I'm fine, no problem, I'm doing what I'm supposed to be doing. So the ego kind of loves tepidness for a while. But eventually it gets to the point where everybody's so tepid it says, hey, you know what, folks? Why even bother? Let's just stop all this nonsense. And ego likes that even better. It really loves that. Is let's just wipe out, let's just admit that this all this effort you were engaged in for the last thousands and thousands of years, or whenever, however long anyone's tradition has been around, it was all just a myth, you know. You realize that it was just kind of a fanciful, whimsical myth that you were pursuing, and now you're in the right track here with the ego's plan of salvation. Let's deepen this coma and succeed in that, which is ultimately trying to annihilate yourself. That's what the ego really is after. So it's at a point now where it's made everything very tepid, made everybody feel very uncomfortable and uneasy with their practice and with their faith. Crushed the will in so many different ways that people now are really thinking, you know what? I wonder if this is all just, it was all just kind of a whimsical trip that I was on. And I really was kind of a spiritual romanticism, you know, thing that really wasn't grounded in reality. I wonder if that's what's been going all along. And this is what's being pushed on society. You know, Jesus is being made into a sex symbol now, you know.
Yeah.
An idolatrous personality, like an ideal leader of the personality cult. That is what is, that's just one example, for instance. That they're glamorizing Jesus into a personality, you know, and then this really undermines people's will, you know, to really right spiritual practice. You have to summon your will for right spiritual practice. You have to summon your will. I mean, doing these tapings, I have to summon my will. It doesn't just happen without doing that. No way. You have to have the will to do it. And anything that turns you towards the personality cult undermines your spiritual will, because then you're thinking that I'm really a personality, and therefore I have to use my personality, what my personality wants to do. Well, the personality wants to judge, it wants to gossip, it wants to be titillated, it wants to be frightened, it wants to be shocked, all these things. It wants to judge others, it wants violence, you know, it wants music, it wants all this. The one thing that the personality will never do is right spiritual practice. You'll never do that. It's the spiritual will that does right spiritual practice. It's spirit saying, hey, I'm not the personality, I'm not the body, I'm not perception, I'm not projection, none of this is true, this is not me at all. I am the divinity itself, because there's only one identity. And so everything is divinity itself. There is no other. There's only one God, there's only one identity, there's only one all-inclusive divinity, and I've forgotten what that's all about. I've forgotten. So I need to summon my will to help the grace of God awaken me from this coma of forgetfulness. This is what it's all about. So there's this amazing situation taking place in the world. Very unwelcome situation. Some say that there may be a parting of the ways, that this world is so much in the grips of the ego's plan of salvation that there's going to be some sort of automatic parting of the ways, as it were. Okay, we'll see. Let's not get ahead of ourselves. The first order of business is right spiritual practice. And again, what I'm pointing out is there needs to be some acceptable form to people, so they're not all arguing. The ego loves us to argue about stuff, right? And not ever do it. That's the personality. That's a lack of will. The ego loves to argue over leadership. Who's leading? Oh, you've led for a while. Why don't we have someone else lead? Oh, that's not fair. You know, constantly battling over leadership, who should be doing what. This is all throwing a wrench into your right spiritual practice. it's a entirely unwelcome for those who want to do right spiritual practice. Right spiritual practice comes from those who can summon the will to do it and to motivate and encourage others to do it. Okay, that's where it comes from. It comes from the will, and it's not the ego who is to determine who has that will or who doesn't. The ego doesn't have a clue. The ego thinks that's all nonsense. Places zero value on it. It only wants to create a ruckus and confusion because it loves confusion. It loves confusion because it thinks that total chaos will destroy spirit. It believes that total chaos. It won't destroy spirit, but what spirit will do is say, I can't stand that feeling. And what the ego hopes is that spirit has some way of committing suicide or killing itself. If it thinks that this mental chaos is its actual condition, then it will kill itself or something. It cannot. God did not create that which can destroy itself. So what spirit does is it rejects chaos and confusion and says no. Have to reject it. That's what happens. Been through that personally. That is what happens. So, but the ego loves confusion. It loves discord. It loves power struggles. It loves turmoil. It loves all that stuff. And it loves bringing these issues of, hey, wait a minute, you know, what justifies you being a leadership role? Or how come you're that? How come I don't have that? That's not fair. That's not equality. And you get into all this equality nonsense as if the ego says, well, everybody has equal will to do right spiritual exercises, so everybody should have an equal chance to reassure and encourage others. Is that true? That's utterly not true. Utterly not true. Everybody's at a different place in awakening from their coma. And it's actually very rare for people to have right spiritual will, enough will to do it. It takes an enormous effort to have this will. Most people have like next to none. So what the ego says is it wants to see those who have next to none, who are totally incapable of it, of helping others, and actually only drag everybody down to a black hole. The ego wants them to lead and say, hey, when it's time for them to lead, put them in positions of leadership. That's what the ego wants. The ego, that's exactly what it wants. The ego knows who are those who have the weakest will for right spiritual practice, and the ego lionizes them and puts them on a pedestal and says, folks, this is the example of how, this is how you're supposed to be. This is the role model for you. These are the role models for you. We're in a crisis of role models on this planet, which has been going on for the last 60 years or more. We have the worst role models imaginable on this planet, the most terrible role models. That's by design. That's the ego saying, I want those who have the weakest will, who have no interest in right spiritual practice, who want to turn towards, you know, the ego's plan. The ego puts them as role models and puts them on the world stage, highlights them, talks about them incessantly, etc., etc., promotes them throughout the planet, millions of mentions of their name and their pictures and everything all over the planet, constantly saying to every young person, every person on the planet, here are your role models, here are your role models, here are your role models, okay? That's what the ego does. And that is what has happened to this planet. And that's an extreme disaster. And the ego insists that any institution, where it's headed for, is all institutions of worship, spiritual traditions, etc. The ego is headed for insisting that its chosen ones be the one in charge of those institutions to make sure, as the ego says, that the inequalities of the past don't happen again and to right the wrongs of so-called inequalities. Okay, that's the ego is very slick and about this kind of stuff. What it really wants is its chosen ones to be in charge, to destroy the institutions, to bring them down into the level of personality, and to keep them there at the level of personality. It's a pragmatic issue in terms of the grace of God. The grace of God is not picking favorites. It's simply pure pragmatism. Who has the will to do it? That's it. Not wait a minute, you have the will to do it, but somebody else doesn't. So you have to not do it and allow that person who doesn't have the will to do it to make them feel better about themselves, to help their self-esteem, you know, help their self-esteem. Oh, they don't have enough self-esteem. As if you put them in that position, they would automatically acquire the self-esteem and say, hey, I'm in this position. I must be a great personality. I must be great. That's idiocy. Okay. Total idiocy. It's like putting a, what kind of analogy can I use? Of a Formula One race car, and then claiming this infinite is Superman because the position they're in. Look at the position they're in. Of course, they can't drive at all, but the ego says, look, they're in this car. They must be great. They must be great. They have no capacity to carry out the function that the ego puts them in. But the ego claims they must since they're in that position. It is like a complete lunacy, you know, whimsical madness that the ego engages in this kind of thing. So the ego just says, hey, just plug in this mind that has no will to right spiritual practice, who's obsessed with the personality cult. Plug them in, put them in the head of some great spiritual institution, and that will solve all. And they must be great. They must be doing fine. They must be doing exactly what's needed, just because they're there. And this appeals to the personality, because the personality again feels it has no spiritual will. So the personality says, "Hey, Dad, that's the remedy. That's the remedy. Just we don't have to do anything except just to be put in this position, and that solves everything." Well, this is obviously not the plan of God. That's the plan of the ego. Plan of God is to put those who have right spiritual will to do right spiritual exercises in the right position to help and encourage others. It's a merit, true merit system. It's a true merit, whereas the ego is a system of no merit whatsoever. Let's throw merit out the window entirely and claim that any claims of merit are biased, unfair attempts to hold down others from experiencing being in that position, as if being in that position is the experience, as if the experience of being in that position equates with functionality in that position, like a toddler in a race car equates with functionality of driving that car. That's what how the ego thinks, and the ego is mad. You know, it's a lunatic. The ego's a lunatic in that way. The ability to function in a position of responsibility comes from dedication, comes from the ability to summon your will, comes from the ability to focus. That comes from a lot of practice and humility. The most important attribute is humility and confession. I have a severe continuity problem, and the willingness to work on that every single day intensely over a long stretch of time to the point where you are able to strengthen your will bit by bit by bit. That's the only way. You don't derive a strong will to awaken from a coma merely by being placed in on the throne. Someone lifting you and placing you on the throne. Do you automatically assume it? This is the idea that things bestow identity. Location bestows identity. So if you just place someone in a certain location on a throne, that automatically bestows great wisdom upon them. That's the ego's notion. Okay, of that identity is based on things, labels, and location. Okay, so the ego thinks, oh, you must have true identity because of the label, the location. We're calling you the great sovereign. We're putting you on the throne, and we're worshiping you. Therefore, you must, everything you say must be perfect wisdom. This is the mad, mad, mad agenda the ego is pursuing in this world. Saying we're all equal in terms of our will to awaken. It is the absolutely untrue, totally unpragmatic plan of the ego. Totally unpragmatic. Ruinous. And the ego says, well, this one over here hasn't been given the opportunity to be on the throne. So let's put them on the throne, and then everybody will feel great. No, they won't, because that one will be totally incompetent and will completely collapse the disciplines necessary, and it will cause everybody to recede deeper into a coma, and so it will be disastrous for everybody. The ego's plan is disastrous for everybody, actually. And again, wise people would not stand for that. With strong will, right, will say, no, I want someone who's truly competent there. I don't care whatever label or location anyone wants to put on them one way or the other. I want someone who is truly competent. I want strong, right, focused will reassuring me and encouraging me and motivating me. And I insist upon that. I'm not into this idiocy. We call it PC, spiritual PC idiocy, which is designed to collapse the whole situation, actually. Okay, taking turns. Oh, okay, you've been on there for 2 years. Okay, now I'm going to bring someone else in. They get a 2-year stint, too. This is madness. This is absolute madness. And the institutions that have a merit system, for the most part, as at the center, the core, they're under a severe attack, claiming that they're unfair, that they're unfair to others. This whole notion of fairness is the ego. The ego says, it's not fair that my plan of salvation doesn't work. It's not fair. We got to at least pretend that it works, everybody, right? No, we don't. No, we don't. Why? Who does that please? It doesn't please anyone. The ego is nothing, actually. So who does it really please? Nobody. So it all gets back to our continuity fear. That those who refuse to recognize that they have a severe continuity problem are going to go with the ego's plan of salvation. They think, well, I just can't awaken. I don't have the will, and I'm too afraid to do so. So the only hope I have is this fairness notion that somehow out of fairness I will awaken because it's my time. Someone else's time, and now it's my time. Just to be fair, I should be happy because that's fair, right? I should be happy. Now, happiness only comes from the soft landing into the vision of oneness. That's the only way. And that only comes through right spiritual practice, the summoning of your will. It's the only way. The ego's way of fairness is total magical wishful thinking and nothing else than that. Nothing else than that. And once that gets a grip of a planet, the planet is finished, actually. This is the crisis that we're in. This crisis of insisting on fairness instead of merit, true merit. Because we refuse to recognize we have a continuity problem out of our pride. Spiritual pride says, no, I don't have a continuity problem. No. I should be able to do it without admitting I have any problem. I haven't forgotten reality. No. It's... because we don't want to admit we tried to uncreate creation. We don't want to admit to God we tried to do it. We're worried that we'll be rejected. We're not rejected at all, because it was just a whim on our part. A silly whim, just out of the sense of adventure. Like, hey, I wonder what kind of adventure this would be like. This might be a really interesting adventure. Let's see if we can do this. It didn't touch God at all. It didn't touch the everywhereness, the total... the one presence. One presence is still exactly the one presence. Nothing has happened to it. But many of us still continue to be in this dark mood of non-repentance. And so this leads directly to this notion of fairness based on no criteria whatsoever other than taking turns. Terrible situation. And the ego always tries to shade all leadership positions towards its position. Tries to shade it that way. And wants to get more and more of those who are loyal to the ego's plan in more and more and more positions. And it's been doing this it's had an unprecedented success due to its ability to glamorize its path, to glamorize it, to glamorize the personality. It's been able to glamorize this planet, glamorize the personality, glamorize its plan to such an extent that people just kind of go along with it now almost automatically. Oh yeah, oh, that's fair. I think that's fair. I think that's fair. I think that's right. And they think they have right judgment now. The personality is able to have this right judgment about what's fair. No, personality can never have right judgment. Personality always is flawed. It's inherently flawed. Only the grace of God has right judgment. Call it what you want. Only the grace of God has right judgment in this situation. And only the grace of God knows what is truly truly merit in our awakening from the coma, because we don't have a clue. We've totally forgotten reality. How can we know what is, how can we know how to awaken to reality, what is merit there, unless we are truly informed by the grace of God? We cannot know. So we have to rely upon the grace of God. Call it the Holy Spirit, call it whatever your tradition is. We have to rely upon that, to work with that, to accept that, okay? To place that first, to place the grace of God first. We confess that we have this severe continuity problem, and we ask the grace of God to strengthen our will and give us this, to practice this soft landing. That's the basic orientation for everybody, without exception. Again, you can use whatever tradition or terminology you want. This is just the basic essential orientation. I have a severe continuity problem, and I accept the grace of God, the judgment of the grace of God, to lead me in the right spiritual path, lead me in the soft landing into the vision of oneness. That's the goal for everyone, actually. The vision of oneness, it is the goal. Because only that truly reminds us of the nature of reality. Only that gives us the soft landing back to full acceptance and remembrance of the nature of reality, and full participation as direct knowing. Only that does it. That's what the grace of God has supplied for us, the vision of oneness. So these are declarations and positions that everybody can take, you know, and the ego, you know, the quibbles the ego can bring about are seen through very easily as just simply quibbles. So I have a severe continuity problem. Say I'm Clarity Rise, I have a severe continuity problem, and I'm placing my faith and trust in the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, to lead me to right spiritual exercises. Okay? Very simple. And then doing them this moment, just as it is totally free of all specialness. This world, just as it is totally free of all specialness. This desk, just as it is totally free of all specialness. This personality, just as it is totally free of all specialness. This place, just as it is totally free of all specialness. When I awaken in the morning, I ask the Holy Spirit, okay, please inform me what the right spiritual practice is of the day. Now, in this day, it directed me to something on the internet that I noticed, and I said, uh-oh, that's crossing a line right there, and basically showed me that this World War III has started today. This ideological battle has now shifted into a higher gear that's worthy of being said. It is a all-out world war at this point, ideologically, and certain ruthlessness is bound to take place now that you would characterize that as a war, really. Ruthlessness, you know, it can be deleting people's accounts, blocking you from internet access, for instance, all that kind of stuff. In other words, shutting your voice down, shutting your ability to communicate down. Those are acts of warfare, actually. Cutting communications in warfare is primary, right? Absolutely primary. We have now the primary means of communication in the world are in the hands of very few people, and it's easy for anybody to just decide, hey, you know what, let's just block them entirely. Let's just block that one, get on this list of those to be blocked. And suddenly you cannot access the internet, etc. And they have billions and billions and billions of dollars to fight any, crush any lawsuit you could possibly bring. And there's really no remedy whatsoever for it. That's what we're talking about here. We're talking about marginalization on this planet of those who are doing right, have the right will, so that their ability to communicate is severely truncated and even brought to a standstill. This is what we're looking at, actually. Very much so. This is what I see is coming, without question. This is why I say it's a war. It's a war. It's a war to silence those who would encourage others to accept the grace of God, the guidance and judgment of the grace of God, and to pursue right spiritual practice, to pursue the soft landing into the vision of oneness. That is the situation we're facing now. And that's a very dire situation. Now, if that comes to pass, then I would say there may be what the Judeo-Christian tradition says, a rapture, meaning those who want to to be communicated to may leave this planet, actually, to some other dwelling place where they can get right communication. Because we are so dependent right now, so dependent on our cell phones and on the internet for communication on this planet, right? And these means of communication are now controlled by a very small, narrow, tiny elite, actually, who are, I say, fanatically involved in the personality cult. And so they could very well take steps to just cut communication from those who are conveying right spiritual will, right advice and right encouragement to do right spiritual practice. And that means those who want to be encouraged will be isolated and feel that they got no one to help them. That's a terrible situation, very terrible. And the places of worship have been watered down so much that if you go to those places, you're not getting the necessary intensity of will from what I see, and I've spent a lifetime observing all the different kinds of services, etc., on the planet, and what takes place and where's the will. And it's just not up to standard enough to really get us into the soft land and get us to the vision of oneness. We have to get to and abide in the vision of oneness. Otherwise, we're still very vulnerable to the ego, and the continuity problem is not resolved for us, which makes us very vulnerable and ambivalent. We have to get there. So it's not enough to tread water. And that's what I see. There's all this water treading in all these, you know, most people's spiritual practice are just treading water. That's not good enough. You need rapid momentum, actually. Not too rapid, but definitely you are moving quickly towards the vision of oneness. That's what has to happen. It's not happening. So there's a stall out. You know, it's a stall out. It's a bad stall out. you don't want the plane to stall out, do you? That jetliner, Malaysian jetliner, you know, what happened to that, for instance? It could be a sign, you know, not a good sign at all, of some sort of rapid, you know, just like the will to fly, right, disappearing, the will to ascend, disappearing, the will to the vision of oneness, to reach that elevated, just vanishing will suddenly gone, the will suddenly gone. That's what I'm concerned about. So I'm saying, if steps are taken to eliminate communication on this planet from those who have the will to give out, to encourage right spiritual practice, then there could very well be this ascension, this rapture of people who want that, going to a different dwelling place so they can have the communication, so they can have the contact that they need to be reassured, to be motivated, to be coached. It's necessary. It's very helpful. It's very difficult to do it all on your own. Very difficult. You need the support. Most people need support. It's possible to do it, but you know, I did it mostly on my own. But I was in a situation where I had some support. I was able to get in a situation where I was able to do it. But right now, oh my gosh, you know, it is really, 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 really tough. At least I had the feeling that it was okay to do it. You know, I grew up in a feeling this was great, this was okay, and I got started, and I got going, and I got the momentum going. Right now, how do you get that momentum going? You know, so it is conceivable that the ultimate result of this war that has begun is that there will be a parting of the ways taking place, that there will be a quote-unquote rapture or ascension, or you know, a lifting into a higher dimension, a higher realm, so that those who want to focus on their soft landing into the vision of oneness can continue to do so. That may very well happen, and indeed in the Judeo-Christian tradition, that's exactly what they say is going to happen, is that there's this terrible time now where the pressure is so severe to crush your will, that and steps will be taken, it will become so, people feel so isolated, that there will be this time when quote-unquote Jesus comes back and takes those on this planet who want to focus on this to another dwelling place. That's when Jesus left this planet. He is quoted as saying, he's leaving this planet to go prepare a place for us, and then to come back at the end of the age to take us to that place he has prepared for us. Those who want to go, meaning those who want to engage in right spiritual practice. Nobody else would want to go to this such a place. Unless, certainly the cult of personality is not, would not be supported in such a dwelling place. This is too different. Where's the glamour? Where's the glitz? Where's the glamour? Whereas if you freed yourself from all that glitz and glamour and personality cult stuff, and you're doing right spiritual practice, you'll say, yeah, that's where I want to go. For sure I want to go there. So in the Judeo-Christian tradition, it is foretold Jesus will return to this planet to take those who want to continue their right spiritual practice, take them to another dwelling place that he has prepared that is ideally suited for that, so they can continue on towards their soft landing in the vision of oneness. That is what we are told. I have no reason to doubt this. I don't have inside information as to when or how or whatever the details about this. I have been given a sense that this is likely to take place, but you know, hey, I don't have any reason to doubt it. I don't have reason to doubt it. It is definitely possible that this can happen, absolutely. And I know a lot of people believe it will happen. It will happen. So that's my viewpoint. My viewpoint is that the words of Jesus saying that he'll come back to this planet are for the purpose of taking people to the dwelling place that he has prepared. Not for the purpose of waging war and crushing the ego on this planet, etc. That's not how I see his words. I believe his words are very unequivocal, that he's coming back to take those who want to go with him to the place that he has prepared so that we may dwell there with him. That's his parting words are exactly that, and not something else. So you got to think that when someone's parting words is going to impart, you know, the essence of what he has to convey, right? So I have to give that the highest, you know, value of what's being said, of what the purpose of Jesus' return will be, okay? Now, I know other people have other interpretations. I know there are some who interpret Jesus' second coming as merely right spiritual practice on this planet, which I hope will take place, but I don't see it taking place very well at all right now, and I see it degenerating very severely, actually. So I do see the ego's plan of salvation following the prophecy in the Bible of even those who are most have the strongest will, are their will is being crushed too, to get it done. That's what I see. So, now, A Course in Miracles, which is purportedly the words of Jesus, doesn't say anything about a rapture or an ascension or that kind of thing. And it seems to lean towards, well, it's the right spiritual practice here. Okay, but, let me put this in the right way. A Course in Miracles is not all the words that Jesus has to say, or all the information he has to convey to us. Okay. It was given out at a certain time when we were in extreme danger of imminent undermining of our will. And there was an extreme necessity at that time to develop enough momentum to overcome what was to come. The ego is a massive blitzkrieg on this planet. And that was the real point of it, really, was that it was a timely, something very timely. And it would have undermined its purpose if it tried to put in any information about any ascension, rapture, etc. It would have undermined its purpose. And it would have, so, just because it's not in there doesn't mean that it's not going to happen. All right, and I know a lot of those who study A Course in Miracles, they say, there's nothing in there, and it's only about my practice. It doesn't mean it's not going to happen. It means that it would have been put too much of a burden upon us to conclude that in there. because we were so enmeshed in this side trip of psychology, okay? We needed to break free of that. And the stigma of the notion of rapture was so severe within the times where psychiatry, psychology ruled the day, that you would have felt like you're an idiot. If that was included in there, you would have, I know I probably would have dismissed it and said, I can't do this. This is too far out there. No way. So I believe Jesus may have left certain pragmatic stuff out of it, A Course in Miracles, so it can meet its objective properly and then later convey this to us when we're mature enough to put it in the right context. That's how I see it. So for me, A Course in Miracles did help me develop enough momentum. Okay. So it was absolutely instrumental. But that doesn't mean that I believe it holds everything that needs to be said to us. I believe there are some other facets that need to be communicated to us. There's no question about that in my mind. And, you know, I believe the Holy Spirit has been communicating this to me, has been pointing out to me all the problems, the troubles, what's going on, saying, look at this, see this, just notice this. So the Holy Spirit has been working to help me notice what's going on in this world and has shown me there's this drastic problem on this planet. Drastic. Jesus didn't say anything about that, and of course, because it would have placed too much of a burden upon us. He did not really relate us to the times that were to come. At that time, it was I think it was published in the early 70s. It was not really pointed out to us. It was pointed... I started studying in 1978. It might have been published in 76. Some people had earlier versions, you know, earlier in the early 70s, etc. But let's say just the 70s, the mid-70s, okay, is a better way to put it, the mid-70s. At that time, it was what we needed to hear. I guarantee you that. That is absolutely true. I will testify that. It's exactly what we needed to hear. But right now, there's other stuff we do need to hear. Because the internet and the smartphones and this all this technology, that was not present in the mid-70s. It was not present at all. And this whole glamorization that's taken place, and the whole ideological shift that's taken place, and the demographic shift that's taken place, where the attitude of young people, which tend towards the personality a lot, because they're like, wow, you know, look at this. So look at this experience of having all this judgment and all this stuff. Wow, and tend to glamorize it, try to stabilize it, and they're all hyped up about the attraction they have to other bodies, you know, and so. The demographics have shifted. So we're in a situation right now that is drastically different than the mid-70s from a pragmatic standpoint. Drastically different. And yet, if Jesus would have told us about that ahead of time, we couldn't have related to it. There's no way we could have related to the situation. Pre-computers, okay? Pre-computers. Totally pre-computer time. Pre-high technology. The Course in Miracles published pre-high technology. Totally. So, if it tried to convey what that was like to us at that time, we couldn't have handled it. We would have dismissed it. It would have been too much for us. The curriculum was already such a huge challenge. It would have been too much. So, Jesus really did not speak about that, and let the Holy Spirit educate us. Okay, that's how it goes. It was not trying to cover all bases at that time. It was giving us the right boost we needed at the time. Pragmatism, perfect pragmatism at work. But the Holy Spirit has been educating us and educating us and educating us, saying, hey, wow, look what's going on. And making us very wise about what's going on here. That's its role. That is its role. So Jesus did his right role. Holy Spirit's been doing its right role. Put them together. So don't be surprised if this war that has started starts snipping the communication in many different ways, starts banning people, taking more extreme measures. We up to this point, we've had severe social pressure to conform to the ego's plan of salvation, to its notion of non-merit-based take-turnness, as if somehow that leads to vision of oneness. No, it doesn't. The ego's vision of oneness is everybody having the same amount of money or food or position. It says, hey, see, we're all one. That has absolutely nothing to do with the vision of oneness. The vision of oneness is to see everything just as it is, to recognize everything just as it is, with the widest amount of differentiation possible. Whatever it is, doesn't, whatever could arrive, both manifest and unmanifest, all has the same one identity of everywhereness. That's the vision of oneness. The ego knows nothing about this. It thinks there's some kind of social fairness is the vision, is the oneness we're after. That's what it thinks, and it's trying to give us what it thinks we want. And it's totally deluded about this. Okay? Just one second. All right, it's probably time to wrap this up. I've been really needing to get this out there. So we will see what other details come to light soon. And God bless everybody, the blessings of the grace of God upon everyone, and the blessings of the right of enough will to actually engage in right spiritual practice. You can start by saying, I have a severe continuity problem. This moment, just as it is totally free of all specialness. I would say this is like, you could say this is like a root practice. This moment, just as it is totally free of all specialness. This place, just as it is totally free of all specialness. This planet, as it is totally free of all specialness. This universe, as it is totally free of all specialness. This can be done wherever you are. I actually practiced it in the Catholic Mass I was in last Sunday, and I was feeling so confused and disoriented, like, wow, I can't practice. And I realized, wait a minute, this moment, just as it is totally free of all specialness. I was able to do that. Immediately felt centered. I felt this centeredness immediately. It's amazing what happens. And you just say, oh, I'm back into right will, right spiritual practice, just like that. So I have a severe continuity problem. This moment, just as it is totally free of all specialness. This place, as it is totally free of all spaciousness, of all specialness. This universe, as it is totally free of all specialness. Okay? Very great. That's it. Okay, I'm getting summoned. Getting someone to eat food, which is also a pragmatic function. Very great. Just say, I have a severe continuity problem. This moment as it is totally free of all specialness. And then you can expand it to whatever you see. This crisis as it is totally free of all specialness. That will center you in your spiritual will, which is what is required in order to move towards the soft landing of the vision of oneness. All right, very great, that's it.